Hello and welcome to Top Landing Gear and more from our trip to Lincolnshire, Bomber County, where we've been featuring the Avro Lancaster in this its 80th anniversary year. We'll be returning to the Lank in a few weeks' time, specifically the one that flies with the BBMF. But in this episode, we're moving right up to date with the Typhoon. We were given unprecedented access to the Typhoon operation during our visit to RAF Coningsby, including each one of us flying and in most cases landing the Typhoon sim. The Flt Lt Nick Callinswood was our brilliant guide and flying instructor, to whom we're extremely grateful. And you'll be able to hear some of what we got up to later, and the whole story in our full Flaps edition, which drops a week after this episode, so it may well be there right now. Just a reminder of who we all are. We're back again as a four-piece on vocals. Singer-songwriter with Scouting for Girls and Microlite trainee Roy Stride.
Hello.
Often found running his fingers up and down an old keyboard before accidentally pressing Control-Alt-Delete. Our professional pilot, James Cartner.
Hello.
Just digging the whole scene, or more likely seen digging a hole, our agricultural fencer, Jez Curling.
Hello.
And drummer, trumpeter and raspberry blower, but still always full of hot air, me, Rob Curling. Welcome, everybody.
Hello.
Thank you.
Last week we did Dambusters. We've talked RAF Scampton. This time we're RAF Coningsby. We've got the Typhoons, which was a most amazing trip. But first of all, should we go straight into our Ask James segment?
Why not?
Have we got any questions for James?
We've got a question from... There's a few come in. Please send us your questions. Because we are a little bit short on questions now.
Mm.
This one is from Christos, who has been a big fan of the podcast from this.
Number one fan.
Hi, guys. So pleased Series 3 is here. I've missed listening to you over the last few months. So I have a question for James. Nothing technical at all. But is it commonplace for individual aircraft to be named? I remember it being mentioned in Series 1 that Amy Johnson's Gypsy Moth was called Jason, which is a wicked name for her. Jamie, our guitarist, he had a dog called Jason, which is...
I had a dog called Dave. That was brilliant. But not an aircraft.
So Nick, Christos is wondering if this is something that happens regularly, either officially or unofficially as a nickname. I assume this is more likely to happen with military and private aircraft, But does this happen with airliners too?
Yes, it does happen with airlines. Virgin Atlantic proudly name all their aircraft. If you look at a Virgin aircraft, it has a name on the front.
Oh, yes.
And it's often... It's either something to do with Virgin's history or something quite sort of... en vogue, and they've always, until recently, had a young lady painted on the front of the Virgin aircraft. Which I believe they are changing.
Are they?
And they're either getting rid of the young lady because it's not considered appropriate in these times, or putting some young men on them as well. I'm not sure what the plan is.
Yeah.
But Virgin have been very proactive. It's part of their image to sort of have named aircraft.
Yeah.
And if you look at some of them, as I remember, there was one called Tubular Bells, which was how Branson made all his money.
Mike Oldfield.
Yeah.
That's his first signing, wasn't it?
It was his first signing. And, basically set him up as a record label. And others, you can see the registration number has something to do with it, what the aircraft's called.
Mm.
So it's always worth looking out at Virgin Aircraft for the name of those.
Is that like having a personalised number plate? Can you have some input into the registration number of the aircraft?
Yes, you can. So... we're getting slightly off the top, but you can. So you get what's called in sequence registration numbers. So basically, the CAA works through. If you register a new aircraft, the next one is G for Golf because it's a British aircraft, and then I don't know whatever we're up to at the moment, C D D E or something, and the next one is C D D F. However, you can ask for an out of sequence registration if it's something. But once a aircraft has been registered, you cannot use that registration again on any aircraft.
Oh.
So you can't then
take
it off.
It's unique to that airframe.
You can change the registration of that aircraft, but you can't ever use that registration number, those letters again. And different airlines have, I think Virgin's all start with GVS and then, GV and then three letters that identify them. British Airways, if you look at them, it's normally to do with the fleet type. So, for example, the 787s all start with ZB. Oh. Because if you take the bottom off, it looks like a 78 ZB.
That's clever.
So there's all sorts of different reasons why They have, and normally big airlines like to have a consecutive consecutive letters with some sort of relevance to the.
In the RAF, was there a particular reason why so many of them? I don't know if it's all of them, but again with X, like the Vulcan XH558.
Yeah, I mean X and Z seem to be the sort of the favours, the favourite sort of two letters to start with. Again, I think they just started at Z and went backwards.
Right.
A lot of the just the Shackleton was an aircraft I was very interested in. A lot of those were WRs and things like that back in the 50s.
So they seem to have started at the end of, near the end of the alphabet. Pumas were all X, XV, XZ, something. And as far as names, getting back to the names thing, military aircraft sometimes have names, sometimes they're given by the engineers. For example, we had one that I think was X-ray Victor Treble 2, and it was known as Tremblers. Because of the treble two, but also it used to shake like
Puma.
Puma, yes.
Was it when you flew?
It was. Did it before I flew it,
and then it didn't fly again.
But I remember my father used to work for Laker, and all their aircraft were something Bell, so it was Eastern Bell. Some airlines do name their aircraft.
British Airways do, don't they? I mean, a lot of certainly the old jumbos. There was City of Birmingham and City.
They did. They used to. They haven't for a while. No, as far as I know.
What about military aircraft which you've flown, apart from Tremblers?
No. I don't think military aircraft in the RAF rarely have names themselves.
But would you wouldn't call, like...
Well, you normally refer to it by its last two letters of its registration number, and that sometimes forms a sort of a bit of a word.
So when you were flying Pumas, were you in the same aircraft every time?
No, so the squadron has, say, 12 aircraft or 15 aircraft that it uses.
Yeah.
And you'd be in one of those aircraft. And they're constantly going through different servicing schedules and everything. So you have whatever's available. Okay. And so the aircraft of the day are allocated and then they put sorties in to fly those aircraft. So
a bit like Tremblers, presumably you would go, oh, that's an old dog, that one. Oh, no, I can have that one.
Often you find they're in slightly different fits as well, so they have slightly different equipment. Or they try and be standard, but you'll find, oh, this one hasn't got the GPS working, and that one's only got one GPS, and most of them have two. But they try and get them all in standard fit.
I like that. Brilliant.
So there are names. Airliners particularly do have names. Private aircraft, obviously a lot of people name their aircraft, and you're entitled to do. There's the old ship's sort of the myth with the legend, if you change an aircraft or change a ship's name, it's supposed to be very bad luck.
Oh, really?
So I think this is the problem with naming an aircraft. You don't want bad luck when you're flying.
Exactly. Right.
Just finding out who the pilot is can be bad enough sometimes.
Yes.
Good, lovely. Well, Jez, what about some quick facts?
Okay.
On the Typhoon.
Yeah.
It's a very quick jet.
It's a very quick jet, faster than these facts may seem.
Right.
I'll try and get through them, and hopefully some of them might be interesting. So here we go. Eurofighter Typhoon quick facts. The history of the Eurofighter Typhoon goes way back to 1979, with the UK and West Germany embarking upon the European Combat Fighter Study, which the RAF hoped might help them to find a replacement for the Harrier and Jaguar, and subsequently for the Phantom and Tornado. France, Italy and Spain also became involved in a five-nation consortium, but progress was slow. The British government decided to press on, and in 1983 ordered a pair of experimental demonstrators, but only one was built by BAE, using RB199 engines as used in the Tornado. This experimental aircraft is in fact hugely impressive and very close in layout to what eventually emerged as the Eurofighter Typhoon. France left the consortium in 1985 to go its own way, and in 1987, the remaining four nations pressed ahead to develop engines and radar for the European fighter aircraft. And this successful collaboration eventually led to the first German-built demonstrator aircraft, DA-1, flying for the first time on the 27th of March 1994. BAE's DA-2 aircraft flew just a few days later on the 6th of April, and further developments continued. 1998 saw the aircraft named the Typhoon for export and the RAF, the Tifoni by the Italians, Tifon by Spain, and rather uninspiringly, the EF 2000 by Germany, a very Teutonic. More developmental iterations of the aircraft were produced until 2004, when full production was ready to begin. In the spring of 2005, 17 Squadron, the Typhoon Operational Evaluation Unit, and 29 Squadron, the Operational Conversion Unit, moved to RAF Coningsby, and there on the 1st of April 2006, three Fighter Squadron reformed to become the jet's first operational unit. Initially, the two-seat and single-seat aircraft were limited to air defence roles, although with huge capability. They took over responsibility for the UK QRA, the Quick Reaction Alert, in 2007, and have been setting off car alarms ever since. Continuing progress saw the Typhoon developed as a swing roll platform, meaning it was equipped with sensors and weapons for multiple roles in a single mission. This ultimately led the Typhoon to take over core Tornado roles once this aircraft went out of service in March 2019. And first combat operations of the Typhoon were in Libya in 2011 for Operation Elami, and then Operation Shader in Iraq and Syria in 2015. It also contributes to the Baltic air policing effort and bolsters NATO air defences over the Black Sea. This is in addition to its QRA role in the UK and, of course, the Falkland Islands. The RAF Typhoon Force based at Coningsby and Lossiemouth currently stands at five frontline squadrons plus the OCU, 9 Bomber Squadron, 12 Squadron, which is a joint UK-Qatari unit, which we actually saw on our trip to Coningsby. Yeah. I think there were some high-ranking officials turned up.
Was it Qatari or Oman?
Qatari.
Yeah. Beg your pardon.
That's okay. And 41 Test and Evaluation Squadron. The aircraft is powered by two Eurojet EJ200 turbofans. It's 15.9 metres long, has an 11-metre wingspan. An all-up weight of 21,000 kilos, includes 11,000 kilograms of fuel and armaments. And breaks off to Mach 1.5 at 35,000 feet, takes less than 2.5 minutes, which is quicker than a Puma. to date, around 570 Typhoons have been produced. The RAF operates about 157 of these aircraft, with a cost to the UK taxpayer of around £90 million each. And there are some facts on the Typhoon.
They're not cheap, are they?
£90 million quid each?
That's as best as I can ascertain it, yeah. The Germans have just ordered... I did make a note of this, I've forgotten. Something like another 16. Hmm. But of course it is now quite an old aircraft.
It's insane to think it started in the 70s.
Yeah, I think actually they first talked about replacements in 71, but this, you know, talking specifically about this type of aircraft was around about 1979.
Yeah, and then throughout the 80s, and I think I've mentioned this before, when I was working on Farnborough Airshow for the BBC, it was every 2 years, wasn't it? It was a story about this wretched European future aircraft, and then the next time it was called something else, like the EAP or something, wasn't it? And then it was given another
EFA,
name.
I think.
And it's still... Well, it had all these different names. Yeah, yeah. And then... you know, it eventually flew, I think, for the first time at Farnborough in 1996, I think, with John Turner, who was the test pilot. But it just took forever, and it was just a continual story with a wooden mock-up sitting in at Farnborough.
Very pared-down history of it. And I mean, there were millions of iterations of it, and endless test flights and trials, and it didn't have radar to start with, and they put a radar in it, and it became another iteration, you know. So,
well, I think that has been how the design has been built from the outset, was these different tranches, I think they call them, for the
tranches, blocks, and something else. So,
it's the same airframe, but it's new equipment going in, and that's it.
Yeah. I think a tranche 4 now is what the Germans have just ordered loaded of.
And as I think we've mentioned before, you know, the change from the Tranche 1, they were talking about the Tranche 1 as if they were obsolete, old, you know, almost comparing it to a Phantom.
Yes.
When we were there, look at those, there's a Tranche 1.
Yeah.
They look just like that one. Oh, but look, that one's got a tiny little thing.
I think it's a stunning aircraft. I mean, I love the look of it. I think it's one of the prettiest aircraft in recent times.
And amazing to air shows, if you're lucky enough to see it.
From a pilot's point of view, one of the fascinating things is it can't fly without thousands of computers keeping it airborne all the time. It's inherently unstable.
Yeah. And what is that all about, James? It's to do with manoeuvrability.
Yeah, so the more unstable something is... So if you're in an airliner, you want nice and stable. You want great big wings.
Yes.
And to just sit there, and if anything happens to it, it wants to go back to where it was. For a fighter, if you want it to turn, you want it to damn well turn. You don't want it to have any resistance at all. So it's been designed to be inherently unstable. So if you do anything, it'll almost accelerate into that turn rather than stay where it was before. And so they've built this thing, and I think it needs computers to constantly be adjusting the pitch on the canards to keep it flying. And I think if they do have a... I think one of the things they said, if they have a total electrics failure, it's take the Martin Baker lift out of there and go and swing from some silk.
Have they lost any? Have the RAF lost any?
Yeah, we have lost one or two, I think.
Yeah. Apparently it's got like a... It's got a get out of jail button. Mm. So if you lose control, you press the button and it just takes you straight level.
Oh, that's right. I think Nick showed us this, didn't he? Yeah, it's quite a useful button for us all.
Yeah.
I think we use that a lot in the sim.
What was one of the interesting things that I'm sure it was going to be touched upon in... But was quite interesting was Nick pointing out to us that the two-seaters are going. So how do you train them? Well, you don't.
Yeah, you do the sim.
You do the sim, and then you're live on your own.
Because the sim was, like, it was an amazing experience for us. But that's not like flying. Like, you know, I've done sims before, and when you actually fly, it's very, very different. You can make it as real as you can.
I mean, you are looking at people who have come down the whole fast jet training system. Yeah. So they've been in a Hawk.
Yeah.
They've done, and the Hawks, we're in Hawk 2 now, which are much more swept up cockpits than those that I flew with. So it's designed to replicate the sort of screen they're going to get, similar type performance to that they're used to. So going, you're not going straight into a Typhoon from the street.
Yeah.
You're going in from a Hawk.
Yeah. So it's not teaching you how to fly. It's teaching you how to operate that aircraft.
But there again, saying that, the difference between having two, what are the EF?
EJ200s
behind you, as opposed to a single...
Yeah. 20,000 20,000 pounds of thrust per...
Yeah. It's going from a sort of a really nice Aston Martin to a Formula One car with rockets on it.
and your first solo is the first time you
first
ever fly.
Is your solo?
Yeah.
So it's incredible. Yeah. That's the level of training we've got to.
Would you love to have flown it?
No, I'm really happy with the Puma. It was nice and slow. Yeah, I'd love to fly anything. But it's just, I mean, when we did the sim, this is the. Where we are with fighters now. Remember speaking some way back to our first ever episode, speaking to Jim Schofield about the Harrier. And, you know, Harrier pilots were always considered pretty damn good. Mm. And it wasn't an easy aircraft to operate and fly. And then on top of that, you're a single seat and you've got to go and fight it.
Mm. He had a great quote. He said something like, "You always felt when you got in a Harrier, it was trying to kill you."
Yeah, exactly.
And we lose judgment for a second. You're five fields to the right.
Whereas where we've got to now is that the aeroplane can fly. It can't fly itself, but it helps you out. Mm. It's not trying to kill you. It's trying to make you do what you want to do, which frees up so much more capacity for fighting the fight.
Yeah.
Mm. And it's, I mean, we all found it reasonably, I think all of us, found it straightforward to fly in the sim.
Yeah.
It wasn't a difficult thing to fly with a little bit of basic coordination.
Yeah. I think that's one thing that was really driven home to me is that these guys now, of course they're pilots, but they are systems operator now, over and above almost anything else, because there's no guy in the back seat like there was in the Tornado doing all the weapons and navigation.
Mm.
So you have got to be left enough time to deal with all that stuff, so the aircraft's got to be able to fly itself.
Yeah. So it's a, but you know, the aircraft can do that, and everything is there to help you out. Still saying that, we're talking about, well, if this goes down, you look at that screen and click three times right on that, and then you go to that one and do two on that, and you select the next set of screens.
And then it was this one doesn't work.
Yeah. And then that one stops working, so you, and then you I'd have died about then.
Yeah. You imagine the speed that thing's going. Probably.
You're doing seven. I mean, normal. You're doing 7 miles a minute.
Wow.
Which is a mile every sort of 7.5 seconds.
Yeah.
You haven't got a lot of. There's not a lot of sort of time in there to go, oh, shall I do this or shall I do that?
I can't remember what order to do this in.
I literally nearly crashed my car the other day trying to select like the radio station because it's a touch screen thing.
The worst
it just doesn't
things,
work. And I pressed something. Nearly went, I would, like, imagine flying it. Yeah. Mach 1.5.
Yeah. At least there are fewer cars up there.
But I would love to have flown it. I mean, there are so many aircraft that I'd love to, but...
You can't even go as a passenger now, can you?
That's quite a thing. But, it's amazing bit of kit.
It was a genuine... I mean, that whole trip was amazing, but to go into an operational base... Yeah. To look at our frontline fighter aircraft, walk through a hangar full of these things with the pilots and the ground crew all there was a proper thrill. It was proper boys' own kids. I mean, it was brilliant. It was quite a long time ago now for us, but it does, you know, thinking, I haven't really thought about it much until I'm talking. It was properly exciting. And then you said, you can get in if you want. He said, and to the point where he said, no, you can't talk about this bit.
Yeah.
Please don't take a photo of that bit.
Yeah.
It's like that episode from Thunderbirds and little kids. You know, you can't take pictures of Thunderbird 1. And they've got that camera tracker and the hood always takes pictures and then gets caught because he was so stupid.
He should have started a podcast and he should have gone away with murder, couldn't he?
Yeah, he could have gone away. But, you know, you thought, are we going to have to assign the Official Secrets Act?
Yeah.
It was absolutely epic. It really was.
Well, look, shall we hear a little clip of our behind-the-scenes trip then? Access most areas, I think we can say. Visit to the RAF Typhoon Squadrons at Coningsby, which is one of two quick reaction alert stations which protect UK airspace. Our guide, as we've been saying, was Flight Lieutenant Nick Callinswood, who showed us around an operational Typhoon FGR-4, even let us sit in the cockpit, as Jez said, and then gave us all a go in the Typhoon Flight Simulator. Well, top landing gear, I'm incredibly privileged. We're actually standing in a hangar at RAF Coningsby, surrounded by Typhoons. And that in itself is quite a thrill. But with us, our guide for this little trip here, this tour, is Flight Lieutenant Nick Callinswood, or Cav.
Cal.
I can't read properly.
No, it's fine. Sorry, Cal. My phone was in the way.
But Cal, you fly these fabulous machines. Just tell me what their role is.
So the Typhoon is actually a multi-role aircraft, so we're kind of jack of all trades, master of none, really. Originally, the concept for Typhoon was a air superiority fighter, but obviously since its inception, probably late 80s, early 90s, kind of aircraft have evolved and we've realised that we can't just stick to one role for an aircraft. So that's why she's kind of evolved. Now she's a kind of all-round air-to-air weapons, air-to-ground weapons, jack of all trades.
Yeah. But that's not what the original design was for.
Air defence fighter. That was what she was going to be, an air superiority fighter, missiles, that was it.
Okay.
But obviously with cost and evolution of jets and designs, they've gone, right, no, actually we can do more with that. We can strap some bombs on it and it can be a pretty hefty air-to-ground platform as well as air-to-air.
It's always interesting, isn't it, when something is then... has to undertake a role that it wasn't originally designed for. How well has it transferred to its additional role?
So pretty well, to be fair. It was never designed to carry weapons, but it's obviously been, I like to call the Typhoon a bit of an iPhone. So on the outside, they all look pretty much the same. You change the software, a few of the black boxes on the inside, and you've got a new aircraft. And that's kind of the idea of the Typhoon. So we can update the software quite easily, and it gives you a completely new capability. Obviously, what we pointed out before, the Tranche 1 over there, so that's pretty much just an air-to-air fighter. We can put some old air-to-ground munitions on there, but nothing like we're carrying today. So that kind of limits its ability. So that's why we've then upgraded the aircraft to the Tranche 2 and the Tranche 3 that we see in front of us, and they can do the full role of multi-role with Brimstone and Pavoy 4, all the smart weapons that the Tornado used to have.
Which is what you came off?
Yes.
So what? And that was you were doing ground attack Tornado?
Yeah. So Tornado again, back in the old days where we just went, right, this platform could just do this job. Yeah, I was part of the 2D brained mud movers GR4. Yeah, as we got picked on a lot.
And how does it to convert? So obviously you're in mud mover mode for your first tour. Now you've got to also think about air defence, which is. Although there were crossovers always, it was generally if you were a mud mover, you stayed mud. And if you were an air defender, you stayed in the air defence. So to move in from mud moving to the air defence role, how's that gone down?
Yeah, it's a big jump. I think it'd be harder for the air defence guys to jump into the mud moving role, personally. Right.
They're going
to
look at maps and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Printing and sticking was always hard for us. It's a big jump, actually, just to kind of appreciate the world is bigger than in your cockpit, and just kind of appreciate all the air-to-air, we call it ballet, but air-to-air fighting of how to employ different numbers and different threats. Mm-hmm. And as well as now, right, I might also be trying to get my bombs to a target, so I'm doing my original job, but I'm also fighting my way there in the first place as well. So it's exciting, but it's busy.
So as an air defence aircraft, obviously it's older now than some of the new stuff coming out, but I gather it still holds its own against anything that's coming out of the factory
these days. Definitely, and with some of the newer weapons we've got, obviously it's fitted traditionally with AMRAAM, so mm-hmm. American air-to-air medium-range missile. We've just
That's radar-guided.
That's radar-guided, yeah. So decent mech scan radar in the nose as well, which will be upgraded to what we call an E-scan, so electronically scanned array, which is pretty much what all the fourth-gen fighters around the world have got. Yeah. But we've just started adding into the inventory a missile called Meteor as well, which is a long-range air-to-air missile as well, which is an awesome piece of kit.
That's a fire-and-forget type thing, was it?
It still needs radar lock, but does, pretty much fire-and-forget.
And do you still have any sidewinder sort of capability, or IR?
So we do have IR, yeah. So obviously this is where Typhoon excels. So the fact that it's got really powerful engines means that we can get these weapons really far, really fast, and throw them a long way. Mm-hmm. But also, if we do get into that dogfight arena, then Typhoon's an absolute beast, and we've got that IR backup. They're not sidewinders.
IR being what? Sorry?
Infrared.
Yeah. Infrared.
It's heat seeking, basically. Yeah. But no gun.
Oh, we have got a gun.
Do you have got a gun?
Yeah,
okay.
She's nestled in there.
Oh, it is a gun.
When we start looking around the aircraft, I'll kind of point out where it is, but we carry about 150 rounds maximum, but they're 27 mil, so they're fair size. and they come out at a fair rate.
And is that radar
as well.
Assisted as well? Is it?
There is a moding for a radar assist in there as well, but generally it's a kind of point and shoot point type and weapon and spray.
A huge thanks to Nick Callinswood for what was just the most amazing afternoon, and the privileges we got was just amazing. You were able to hear our full trip on that day in our full Flaps episode, which may be there already, depending on when you're listening to this. So
I just want to say a big thanks to his lovely wife, Bex.
Yes.
Who they're now expecting a baby.
Oh, really? Marvellous.
Yeah. Congratulations.
And she works for the BBC, and she was instrumental in getting scouting to do our song Home with the Lincolnshire Choir,
which I love.
And and through that she was following us and saw Top Landing Gear and said, I'll try and sort you out. So
well done, Roy.
A plug for that song, Lincolnshire Sings Home.
Yeah, it was really good
on BBC.
I love it.
That's a brilliant.
Yeah, they did amazing. It was a raw. She organised it all. It's like the Philharmonic Orchestra on there. Brilliant.
Yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. I love that song. It is. I hum it all the time. And that's mad.
And that is how that all came about.
Mm. Isn't that amazing?
So thanks, Nick.
And it's a great video as well. Mm.
And Nick as well. He's like a real life Top Gun.
He really
looks a bit
looks
like,
and he loves a sports car.
Yeah, he's got bikes.
He's too nice. He's a lovely, lovely bloke.
Yeah.
He's not an idiot. He's such a lovely guy.
Yeah, it was brilliant. Thank you.
Yeah, it's
so
a great
much,
story.
Guys,
not all of which would have made the edit as well. I can think of one in the Falklands, which I know he can't. which can't be broadcast.
It was brilliant. Right, guys, let's see how much you really know then about the Typhoon with the Top Landing Gear Typhoon Quiz. Any buzzers for this, people? Modern buzzers, maybe jet type buzzers? Jim?
I've gone for the thing that sets off all the car alarms. Hopefully this is a Typhoon giving a sonic boom. Ready?
Yes.
It does sound like some Lego falling over, but that was a Typhoon recorded in Lincolnshire.
Great.
Giving a sonic boom.
Wonderful. Thank you. Jez, what have you got?
Well, it's tricky, this, because basically I had another Typhoon going, making lots of noise.
Yeah.
But I actually found a clip of, bearing in mind the ease with which we managed to fly this thing in the simulator.
Yes.
I found an RAF pilot describing flying the Typhoon on a video.
And this is probably the easiest aeroplane I've ever flown.
That's it. That's all I could think of. It's relevant, if not very interesting.
Great. Super. Roy?
Mine goes back to the fact that he was like a maverick from Top Gun.
Much better than mine.
Brilliant. Good. Here we go. Good luck, everybody. Question number one. The first RAF squadron to operate the Typhoon was 3 Squadron, based at RAF Coningsby. But what was 3 Squadron's other notable first? Yes, Jez.
Were they one of the first squadrons to get the Hurricane?
It's a lovely answer, but it's incorrect. Yes, Roy.
I didn't mean to do that. Yeah. Tornado.
Incorrect. No. It may be correct, but it's not the answer I'm looking for.
Were they the first squadron to operate the Spitfire?
No, they weren't, actually. They're all good answers. They were the first unit to operate a heavier-than-air flying machine back in the early 1900s.
Wow.
I know. That's going back some.
And then heavier than air.
So, yeah, so a hot air balloon would be lighter than air.
Right.
So an aeroplane
is
heavier than air.
Right, okay.
Yeah, it's another way of phrasing it. They're called aerodynes. Hot air balloons are called aerostats. There's a stat for you, Jim.
Aerostat.
Question number two. Which aircraft did the Typhoon FGR-4 replace in the QRA role? Yes, Jez.
The Tornado.
Correct. Absolutely right.
Oh, come on. No, that's not good enough. What? So the Tornado.
Okay.
The Tornado F3.
Good. Well done, James. Correct. Point each.
He didn't ask for the model.
Well, there's quite a big difference in the GR1 or the GR4 and the F3. One is ground attack, one is air defence. They're both Tornadoes, but completely different aircraft.
Yeah, it's a valid point. I might have to be less generous on future answers if they're not as accurate as that, okay? Just saying, Jez. Yeah. Just
okay.
saying.
Fine.
Because there have been complaints about favouritism.
Well, yes, from his wife.
Who's that?
James, well done. That's a very, very good interjection. Mm. Well done.
Originally the F2, before they found the...
don't get any points for being
clever. Don't get cocky.
Yeah, because you know he'll take him away.
What does FGR stand for?
This better be accurate, James.
Yes, James.
Fighter Ground Attack Reconnaissance.
Correct. Well done. Well done. Question number 1, 2, 3, 4. The Typhoon is scheduled to continue in RAF service until 2035, when it's due to be replaced by what? Yes, James. Yes.
Rapier. Is it called the Rapier?
It's not called the Rapier. Incorrect. Jez, you look like you're going
to
buzz.
My phone went into standby and I couldn't get to my buzzer.
I see.
And I have read this, obviously, today when I was writing this, but I cannot remember
Roy.
The name.
F-35.
Begins with R, doesn't it?
No, it doesn't either begin with R or an F or any of that. It, funnily enough, if you think the Typhoon was named after the Typhoon Second World War aircraft, very similar looking aircraft Typhoon was the Tempest.
Yeah.
And the Tempest is what will be replacing the Typhoon. It looks a little bit like an F-35 to the untrained eye.
But possibly unmanned.
It's going to be both, apparently. Mm. It can be manned or can be unmanned.
Mm.
I mean, how does that work? Well, if we're still alive, we'll find out in 2035. Okay, it's a tricky one, this, isn't it? Now, Jez talked about the naming of this aircraft, what had been known as the Eurofighter. It was officially named Typhoon at Farnborough Airshow in September 1998. But what other name had been considered? What was it nearly called? Blank faces. Yes, Roy.
Jason.
I'm going to give you a point for sense of humour. Well done. No, it's not Jason. Anyone any ideas? Where is it? Go on.
Oh, I'm just going to answer.
Yo, Buzz, go on.
And this is probably the easiest aeroplane I've ever flown.
Okay, is he an Australian?
No, he's not. I don't know, he might be. I didn't ask him. What was the question?
It was named the Typhoon in 1998, but what other name had been considered for the Eurofighter?
I think it was just the European fighter aircraft.
No. James.
This is a guess. Hurricane.
Oh, you're so close. Spitfire 2.
No.
Yeah.
They couldn't have.
Exactly. It would have been so wrong. So wrong. And actually, Jez, you mentioned the different names that the different countries have given it.
Yeah.
Because the Germans weren't keen on Typhoon because of the Second World War.
Of course.
So they just gave it a number.
They just gave it a number. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the Spitfire 2, that would have been a shocker.
That, yeah, the Germans would have loved that, wouldn't they?
Yeah, exactly.
So Hurricane's almost like half a point, isn't it?
Yeah, it's almost half a point, Jim, but I think...
Not.
Well, bear it in mind, seeing how you go with the rest of the quiz. Next
the rest
question.
Of the quiz, there's more.
What is the difference between a typhoon and a hurricane? Now, it's up to you how you want to answer this. Yes, James?
A typhoon is in the southern hemisphere, a hurricane's in the northern hemisphere.
Absolutely. Say that again.
A hurricane is in the northern hemisphere, a typhoon is in the southern hemisphere.
It's almost correct. It's not quite right.
Is it? Well, that's...
It's... Go on, Jez.
No.
No. You're going to get your half point. It's the hurricane occurs in the North Atlantic, and it's a typhoon in the North Pacific.
Okay.
So you're close.
That's about as accurate as my tornado answer, which was right, but not enough. That was not even right. Or, come on. That's not half a point. That's just wrong.
It is half a point because of he had got a near half point with the previous answer.
And a
geographical... So he's got two quarters.
I'm going to write to your wife.
Half. Fine, write to my wife.
Right. We talked about the canards on the typhoon, the little winglets at the front of the Delta wing.
Mm-hmm.
But what was the first powered aircraft to feature the canard?
Yeah, I'm buzzing it!
Yes, James.
The Wright Flyer.
How do you know this?
I'm a pilot! It's my stuff!
An old pilot.
You're absolutely right. It was the Wright Flyer in 1903. And you better just explain that, James, because it's a difficult one to fathom. But it's leading edge wing.
So basically, the elevator, the bit that does the the pitch, the controls were at the front on the Wright Flyer. They had a little sort of box kite stuck out the front.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's how they controlled pitch. And then later on, they found it more stable to put it at the back. But now we don't want it to be unstable, so they stuck it at the front again.
That's very a good, good explanation,
James.
Isn't
That's
it?
That's very good. He's getting better at this explaining.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, my word. He's getting better at this explaining thing, isn't he, old James? Final question?
If you must.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Why
is there,
not?
Is there any point?
Sorry. One point,
well,
presumably.
What are the scores?
Not, it's
the scores?
Not, well, the points are like this. Roy has one for an amusing answer.
Yeah.
Jez has one for a correct answer. James has 3.5 for mostly correct answers.
Wow.
And just being chippy and slightly irritating.
Which is irritable. What you're becoming, and I don't want to see that happening.
Because
it's points away.
Well, I apologise.
It's points away,
any,
and you've only got
showing
one.
Any passion at all.
It's not
keep it bland.
I'll give you one more question. It's canard related.
Can I just switch my phone back on because it keeps going off? Right, okay.
Which airliner featured retractable canards? Yes, James.
It's the Concordski, the Tupolev 144.
Correct. Absolutely right. The Tupolev TU-144, the Concordski.
That's way too. It's been a very technical quiz, and it's going to fall. We're, make it more fluffy, rounder, more appealing to the
point away.
How do you spell typhoon?
Well, do you want the German, Spanish, French, Italian?
I found out they're called Tiffies.
Tiffy. Yeah, well, our friend Annette came up with those because she watches the Tiffies coming over our house.
Tiffy?
Yeah, the Tiffy.
I honestly thought she said something different. I came into that conversation halfway through and I was like, what is she talking about?
Yeah, that's if you're
tiffies,
in the know,
tiffies.
And she clearly is.
Yeah.
Yeah, typhoons. Good job. Well, look, the scores have gone like this. Roy has got one for an amusing answer. Gerard got so whingy that his one point has been taken away. 0.
I can't stand whinging at quizzes.
With 4.5 points is our pilot and aviation expert, James Carter.
Well
done, Jimbo.
James.
Well done. Thoroughly deserved.
Back to the righteous place at the top of the list.
I do. This podcast did make me think of one of my favourite ones we did last year, back in November. Just talking about how long it took to... You know, from 1979 to how long it took before it actually came out.
Yeah.
And I remember Graham Williams, Air Vice Marshal, retired Graham Williams. We did a podcast with him, Cold War RAF fighter and fast jet test pilot, and an interview with him. And I remember him talking about how long it took.
Yes, that's
for it
right.
To go. So if you're interested in that,
it's in his book.
It's in his book, which is brilliant, which I really enjoyed. So
still not finished it.
Yeah.
How about Harry?
No, still not finished it. Got to get back to you. Just started reading Lancaster by John Nicol. So now I've got three books.
John Nicol sent me a book, his most recent one, which is Tornado.
Oh, amazing.
Which I'm yet to read. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, we'll
so we'll be
on.
We'll, yeah. we'll get him on to talk about that.
That'd be fantastic. Yeah, yeah, but in the meantime, just go and check out our interview with Vice Marshal retired Graham Williams. Do you think his wife caught him that?
I think she should. Like, yeah. only on a certain circumstances.
Should we call you Flight Lieutenant if James Kartner from now on? Now you've won the quiz.
Why not? What a great way to celebrate your quiz.
Your smugness.
It's a shame, Jez. You've let yourself down very
badly. Well, sometimes it's just a bit irritating.
I'm tired of a quite large weekend.
So you didn't whinge, as the history expert on the pod, you didn't whinge that the battle, the dam bust one was a bit history-related.
And there's no point in talking about it.
Moving
right,
on.
Well, on that happy note, we are a really united team, and it's lovely that we are.
Now we're back together.
Now that we're back together. Yeah.
After the
so,
split.
Just a reminder that coming up on future pods, we'll have more from our trip to Lincolnshire. And after all that fast jet stuff, we're going to slow down the pace a bit when we reflect on the sheer joy we had when we went gliding and flew some microlights as well. And then we'll finish off the series with a trip to the BBMF and a look at their beautiful Lancaster there, PA-474. Don't forget, of course, the full-flaps version of this episode with Nick Callinswood taking us around the Typhoon Squadron at RAF Coningsby. It's been brilliant. In the meantime, you can, of course, listen to all our podcasts from Series 1 and 2. You'll find us wherever you normally get your podcasts. And please do get in touch with us on Twitter, Facebook and Instagram at Top Landing Gear. And do email us your questions for Ask James at info@toplandinggear.com. That's info@toplandinggear.com.
Four Gs.
Oh, dear. No, two. Just the two.
No, but Typhoon's turn at 4G.
Oh, very good.
See what I did there?
Yeah, it's an extra point.
Oh, my gosh.
And however you're listening, I suspect you probably aren't anymore. But do recommend us to your friends and family and leave a review, especially if you've enjoyed it. In the meantime, thank you for listening and bye for now.